Hello students, today we are going to discuss the transaction processing in the advanced database management system subject. And this transaction processing is basically part of the unit 1 of your syllabus. So before going into detail of transaction processing, let us discuss some basic concepts. Now going by this, let us discuss about what is single user system. Single user system means where a system is being used by one user. A multi-user system means where the system is concurrently executed by many users. So mark the word concurrently here. Concurrently means they are basically where the simultaneous execution occurs. So this concurrency here can be achieved either in interleaved processing or the parallel processing. When there is a single CPU where you are executing multiple processes, then the operations within the processes will be interleaved. That is the interleaved processing. Parallel processing means when you have more than one CPUs, and the processing can be done in parallel the CPUs. So that is the parallel processing. Now let us discuss what is a transaction. A transaction is nothing but a logical unit of database processing. Now this logical unit of database can have multiple access operations. Now access operation means either read operation or write operation. Okay, read operation where you read the data item from the disk to the variable in the program variable. Write means the reverse, that is from the, it can be reinsert or update. That means the program, whatever the program variable is storing, that can be inserted to the database, or a database can be, the database item can be updated with that particular variable. Now a transaction may be a standalone program which is written in some high level language like SQL, okay, or it can be embedded within some other program. Now every transaction that occurs, that is always there is a boundary begin and end within which these access operations are included. Okay, so a transaction always has a clear-cut boundary with a begin statement and end statement. Now an application program can have several transactions separated by begin and transaction boundaries. Okay, just consider a big database like banking operation. That is where you have you are going for a withdrawal of some money from the ATM machine. Basically, that is nothing but you are going to perform one transaction on the bank database. Similarly, when you are performing some buying or something like in from an online store, okay, or a shopping website, online shopping website, then it is basically you are performing one transaction, okay. So this is like, you know, or you may be performing some multiple transactions in that particular website. To illustrate all these concepts of performing concurrent execution of the transactions, okay, let us take a very simple example of database. We are considering a database to be a collection of some data items, or you can say named data items, okay. And why we say it's named data items? It is basically we are naming the data items by some alphabets in capital letter. It may be X, Y, Z, like that. Okay. And these items are nothing but some granularity or granular or unit of data, which may be a field as small as a field, or it may be a record, or it may be as large as a disk. So it is depending on the data that you are dealing with. The name will be assigned to either a field or a record or a disk, okay. And then as we have basic access operations, write read item, read underscore item, and write underscore item. Now when the data name item or data item has to be specified within that particular bracket which you are handling with that particular access operation. For read, suppose for example read item X, what does it mean? Basically you are accessing the data item X stored in the disk to a program variable. And for simplifying the illustration of these concepts, we are also considering the program variable to be of the same name as the data item name. So x, if the x is the data item stored in the backend in a disk, then program variable is also x. Okay. So similarly, write item x is basically writing back. That is the writing the program variable x to the disk item x. Okay. So that is the updating or inserting of the values to the disk item from the program variable. We know that basic unit of data transfer from disk to the computer main memory is one block. Now this block can be a record in terms of database operation. It can be a record, it can be a field, it can be a block as a whole. Now read item x operation, access operation, commands can have several steps within it. Now what are those steps? First step is to find the address of the disk block in the disk that contains the item x. Okay, so address of the disk block in the hard disk where the item x is there has to be found out, and then copy that particular item, content of that particular address, to the main memory. Okay, and then from main memory you copy to the program variable x. So that is the read item x. What is write item x? Similarly, it has some set of steps. Now writing the item x means finding the address of the disk block where the item x to be stored, and first that copy that particular content of that particular address of the disk block to the main memory buffer, then copy the item x from the program variable to the main memory and replace the content, that is that x content in the main memory, with that new values, and then store the updated block to the back to that particular disk, the address from where you have copied earlier. Okay, so that is the operation, the write item x. Now for illustration of the concurrency, we are only considering two transactions to exist at a particular for two transactions only for the time being. Okay, although the large databases can have number of transactions being carried out at any moment of time. So we are not concurrency of the transactions. For illustrating the concurrency of the transactions, we are only considering two transactions here, and the begin and end statements we are considering by default, and only the access operations we are considering here. So transition T1 here consists of some access operations and doing some operations on those values, like say read item x. It is performing the read operation on the item x, that is reading the item from the backend disk, updating it by some constant n, that is subtracting the constant n from there, and writing back the item x to the disk. Transition T2 performs the read x, similarly same item it is accessing from the backend, updating with some constant m, then writing the item back to that x. And there is another operation Y, because T2 is not performing anything on Y, so it is just actually just for namesake here. So reading, it is transaction T1 is also performing reading an item Y and adding that particular n, the constant n, to that particular Y. Okay, so we are considering these two transactions only for the time being. Concurrent execution of transactions can lead to some problems, and for which you need to have some concurrency control measures. Now, before going into concurrency control measures, let us discuss what are the problems that may arise, the type of problems that may arise because of concurrency of the execution of the transaction. Okay, so when the transactions are executed in a concurrent fashion, you can have three different categories of problem that may arise. The first category of problem is the lost update problem. Now, what is a lost update problem? This occurs when two transactions access the same database item, and their operations, access operations, interleave in a way that makes the sum value of the database item incorrect. So when a transaction access the database item, because of a concurrence execution, their operations get interleaved, and because of which some database item value becomes incorrect. We'll see in detail with that example, those two examples, T1 and T2. Similarly, the temporary update or the dirty read problem is basically Suppose one transaction has performed some operation on a data item, and then the another transaction has read that updated operation by the earlier transaction, and then the earlier transaction which has actually done that modification or the write operation on that data which is being actually read by another transaction T2 has failed, and because of which the next the second transaction which has actually read the value becomes a wrong one because that the earlier transaction has failed. Okay, so that is the dirty read problem. The third category is the incorrect summary problem. Suppose if one transaction is calculating or doing some aggregate operations on the records, database item records, and number of records you can say, while the another transaction is actually updated those values, you know, doing some arithmetic operations on those database items. Then the aggregate function that was done by, that was being carried out by the other transaction actually may become wrong because the updation was in progress by another transaction. Okay, so that is that becomes the incorrect summary problem. Okay, so these are the three different categories of problem that may arise because of the concurrent execution of the transactions. So that is why we need some concurrency control measures to get the values correct. Okay, now here comes the first category of problem, that is the lost update problem. As I told you, that is the lost update problem basically arises because of interleave execution of the processes or the transactions, concurrently executing transactions. Now here two transactions are executing on the same data items at some point of time. Time is shown here, as you can see, this is the time here, and the transaction T1, which has issued a access operation read item X first, has performed some subtraction, some constant. Say, just consider X to be suppose 10, the N to be suppose 2. So it has performed X minus 2, that is the 10 minus 2. So the updated value becomes 8. Now, it is yet to perform the write item X, but because of the concurrent execution, transaction T2 has started executing and it has read the item X. Now, what item X the transaction T2 will retrieve? Because the write was not performed by X, so on X, so transaction T2 will get the value of original value of X, that is the 10. Okay, though it has actually performed X is equal to X minus N, it is still in the buffer space, not yet written back to the disk. Remember this. Okay, now so when it transaction T2 is getting the value X, reading the item X, it is going to get the original value that is being stored in the disk, and that is the 10. So 10, suppose M is 3 here, so it will become 10 plus 3, it is 13. Okay, so now it is writing back the item X, but the buffer space, in the buffer space of the main memory in the transaction T1, it has the 8, that is the 10 minus 2, 8. So this 8 will be written back to the disk, but after that it has performed another operation, read item Y. It has not much significance here, so I'm just leaving it. Then the transaction T2 is writing the value X. Now what transaction T2 has performed here? 10, suppose M is 3, so 10 plus 3 is 13. So it is writing the item X, that is the updated value in this buffer space, to the disk block. That is the same disk block, data item X. So it will just replace that particular 8 which was being updated here by the transition T1 will be replaced with 13. So obviously this 13 becomes an erroneous result because whatever was being updated by transition T1 have been lost. Okay, it has been replaced by some updated value of the transition T2, and transition T1's updation has no meaning and it has got lost. So it is the lost update problem. Okay, so that is the lost update problem that may arise because of the interleave execution of transactions, concurrently executed transactions. Another kind of problem that may arise is the temporary update problem. So what is the temporary update problem? Again, you see that concurrent execution of these two transactions, T1 and T2. The transaction T1 will have read a particular item X, has done some operation x minus n, has returned back the item updated value to the data item x. Okay, after that, transaction T2 has read the item x, it has got the updated value that is done by the transaction T1. So updated up to this much, this is correct. Transaction T2 has got that updated value, perform each operation on that particular transaction, okay, and then has returned back to the disk x, that is the data name item x, okay, in the disk. And then the transaction T1 is performing on some the other data name item y, and because of some reason the transaction T1 failed. Remember, in a transaction, to have the final saving of the data, it has to perform an operation called as the commit operation. Only when the commit operation is done, it is actually written back, it is considered to be the permanently saved. That is, it is written to the log file. Okay, so we'll come into that in later on. But up to now, whatever was done by the transaction T1 is was actually partially committed. It is not fully committed because it was not commit operation is yet to be performed. Now here, when the transaction T1 has failed, what it means that whatever was read by the X from X by the transaction T2 was erroneous because it was done by a failed transaction, not a committed transaction. Okay, so the result in the item X that has been written back by the transaction T2 is wrong. And this is the temporary update problem. Okay, so this is another kind of problem, concurrency execution problem that may arise. Okay, the third kind of problem can be the incorrect summary problem. Now suppose here a particular transaction was updating some values with some as you can see here, the x is being updated with the constant n, then y is being updated by adding that n. Okay, but in the meantime, there is another transaction which is performing some aggregate summary on the data in the database. Now what happens is that since two transactions are executing simultaneously in a concurrent fashion, the aggregate has been done here, suppose sum is equal to sum plus a, and then the transaction t, because this is a function of time, so here the transaction t has read the item x, subtracted some constant n from x, and returned it back to the disk. Okay, in the meantime, it performs the aggregate operation, which is the transaction which was performing that aggregate operation on the data, reads the item x, adds the value to the sum, that item x value to the sum, and then read item y and sum plus y. But remember here, the transaction T1 is also executing. It has updated x, but it is yet to update y. So value of y that has been performed by the aggregate operation is wrong here, because y is yet to be updated. Okay, so that is called as the incorrect summary problem. Another problem that may arise because of concurrently executing transactions. Now after we have seen those concurrently executing transactions, the problem that may arise because of concurrent execution of transactions, let us see why recovery is needed for the large databases. Recovery is a very important concept. Okay, because there are many treats, or you can say many reasons because of which recovery is required. And suppose for the large databases, one simply cannot afford to lose the data. Suppose just consider the banking database. A bank cannot afford to lose the data which is stored in their database. Okay, so recovery is a very important part in the large databases. So why recovery is needed? The first point is the system crash or computer failure. Okay, so because of the hardware or software problem, the computer system the hardware crash may occur, because of which the computer main memory may get lost. So if the memory is lost, means you need to recover whatever is stored there, whatever was stored there before the crash occurred. Similarly, can transaction or system error. The system error may occur because of some failure, such as suppose the integer overflow or division by zero. Okay, some exception conditions. So in such cases, you need to recover the transactions, the value which were stored earlier before that particular error has occurred. The third reason because of which the recovery becomes essential may be the local error or exception condition. There may be certain situation in which the exception conditions in the database may occur. Suppose in case of the banking transaction, suppose you are trying to withdraw some money from the bank, from your bank account, and there is no sufficient balance in your account. So in that case, your transaction, even though it initially because of some reason it may get deducted, but then it has to recover. Those transaction has to get recovered because of the insufficient fund. Okay, so such exception conditions may result, and which is because of which the recoveries may be required. Similarly, there may be some concurrency control enforcement because of which the recovery may be required. Suppose you may have to abort a transaction, and that may have to be restarted later because it may violate the serializability condition of the transactions, or maybe because of some several transactions are in a state of deadlock. Okay, so I will come into what is serializability later on, but just remember, because of some concurrency control measures, enforcement measures, or maybe you may have to abort certain transactions. Okay, so this is the another reason for which you may have to recover the data. Okay, disk failure may be another reason for because of which you may recover data. Suppose your some disk block has become non-function, okay, because of the read-write head crash, etc. You may have to recover those data in those failed disk blocks. Okay. Similarly, there may be a physical problem or catastrophe. There may be, suppose, air conditioning failure, fire, theft, sabotage. Okay. So there may be many things that may occur because of some physical damage. So then you need to recover those data.